Optimal management of advanced renal cell carcinoma is not clearly defined, and recent developments have further complicated treatment choices. Two noted oncologists, Dr. Brian Rini from the Cleveland Clinic and Dr. Nicholas Vogelzang from the Comprehensive Cancer Centers of Nevada, discuss why this uncommon cancer is raising so many questions.
I've been out of fellowship about 15 years. In that time, there have been 10 drugs FDA approved for kidney cancer, including three in the last 12 months or so. So we kind of had the first wave of targeted therapy maybe 8 to 10 years ago, and now we have sort of this wave of immune therapy and other therapies.
The biggest question is what should be the sequence. I've written about this extensively. I've given interviews on it. And what we did most recently was take a group of practicing docs in the US Oncology Network, put together what we thought was sort of a consensus. And we agreed on first line, second line, third line. But as we were finishing the review article, suddenly nivolumab got approved. And then cabozantinib, and then lenvatinib got approved. Within a matter of 6 months, the review article had become outdated.
As we get more drugs, integrating them into clinical practice becomes more challenging, just the sheer volume of drugs that we have, which is a good problem to have.
Renal cell carcinoma accounts for 3% of adult malignancies. Although the rate of new cases has risen since the 1990s, the death rate has started to fall. And in metastatic disease, median survival has started to improve.
It's the starting dose, okay? Now, you're small and relatively not in the pink of health, but you're not bad. Renal cell patients who used to have a survival of, on average, less than a year, the average patient is now in the 30 to 40 month survival rate. So we've seen almost a quadrupling of the median survival.
I usually quote patients about 3 years or so for average survival now. I think when we see the overall survival from these large frontline trials, I won't be surprised if it's 3 years plus. It's okay, but it's still not great, right? 3 years doesn't sound great to anybody.
Sadly, we're not curing most of those patients. They continue to get benefit from the drugs, but they don't enter remission.
The difficulty in establishing a durable remission in renal cell carcinoma is linked to the disease's genetic heterogeneity and lack of any targetable biomarkers.
The cancer is evolutionarily complex. It is able to display a number of genetic variants. The simplest mutation in renal cell is right at the VHL gene. That's a fairly clear, simple mutation. But as the chromosome damage becomes larger around that chromosome 3 region, you get genetic mutations called BAP or BAP, and that leads to much more genetically unstable disease, more poor risk disease, harder to treat. We don't yet have a full genetic landscape of the cancer, but we do know that the narrow mutation patients do much better than the broad mutation patients.
Unfortunately, in kidney cancer, we don't have really any useful biomarkers, despite many, many years of looking. HER2 status in breast cancer would be a great example of a biomarker that happens to be both prognostic and predictive. But when it comes down to me knowing if the patient expresses this marker, I'm going to give them drug X, and if they don't, I'm going to give them drug Y. And we just don't have that yet in RCC. Patients want to know which therapy is quote-unquote best for them, and we don't really know which one is best. We can guess based on trial data and patient characteristics and things like that, but at the end of the day, it's a guess. We give it and we see what happens.
Kimberly Allman, a nurse practitioner at the Cleveland Clinic, finds that patients with metastatic renal cell carcinoma often do not understand the implications of their diagnosis.
I've had many patients independent of their educational level, kind of question, you know, what metastatic means, and it's news to them that they have an incurable cancer.
And I'll just ask people, what do you want me to tell you? I'll tell you everything you want to know, but some people don't want to hear it. They don't want numbers and median survival and things like that, and other people want the nitty-gritty detail, and they've been on the internet and they've looked up studies. In terms of managing expectations, you know, if I'm starting somebody on, say, a targeted therapy, which is standard, I tell them this is not curative. You know, our goal is to control disease for as long as possible. We hope that changes over time to a more curative approach, but as of now, it's important that they understand that this is going to be an empiric sequence of therapies.
I had a sad case the other day where a young fellow from San Francisco with poor risk disease, granted poor risk, said he just wasn't up for the fight and just decided not to have any treatment and died 6 weeks later. So it's still a very tough disease for some patients. And it is a burden to be treated. You know, it's pills, it's IVs, it's doctor visits. There's plenty of things not to like about the current treatment, but it's a life-extending therapy.
Hi, my name is Kelvin, and I work on the team that creates the content that you've just seen, Medscape TV. If you like the content and want to see more, click on the button to the right, and it'll take you to the full series.